Welcome to Engineering with Rosie. I am just about to jump on a call with Laurent, Segalen and Gerard, Reid. They are the hosts of my favorite podcast, which is called Redefining Energy. They both have a background in renewable energy finance. So the topic that we have planned today is about the renewable energy paradigm shift from cost to value. So it occurred to me a while ago that, yeah, you might have the lowest cost of energy, say, by installing a lot of solar panels, but your solar panels are also generating electricity at the exact same time as all the neighboring solar panels, which makes electricity prices low. So it's not as simple as choosing the lowest cost renewables. You have to choose the one that gives you the best value. And that's where it gets a little bit more complicated than my mechanical engineering brain can kind of grapple with. So I'm really excited to get the benefit of Laurent and Gerard's vast experience with renewable energy finance to talk about some of these issues.
It's very, very important to look at the economics of this.
Yes, it's cheap. But the second thing is to say, where is it?
We need to have smart regulators. There's just no way around this. What I've done is I've spent most of the last 20 years as a financial analyst. What I find very, very interesting today is the cost of solar and wind. If you look across the US, China, India, Germany, solar and wind are the lowest costs. But what's incredible for me is the journey we've gone on. So if I just take the case of Germany, Germany today, if you're generating electricity with solar, it's a levelized cost of energy is about $50 a megawatt hour. Now, if I went back 15 years ago, and I just said, that's not long, 15 years ago, it was at $600 a megawatt hour, right? And if I take the case of wind, we were also up wind. We were up at $100 a megawatt hour, right? So hats off is what I say to the engineers and the innovators in this space.
One thing is to say, yes, it's cheap. But the second thing is to say, where is it? You know, production, where you can produce it and where you can consume it. Solar is much more versatile. You know, you can put it on rooftops, so it's much more decentralized. But when it comes to wind, you will see that, for instance, in China, the gigantic wind resources, they are in the Inner Mongolia, Gobi Desert, or even going to, you know, to Xinjiang, whereas they are 3,000 kilometers away from the main consumption centers. And in a certain way, you will have the same problem in the U.S., you know, the Midwest.
I guess that's the issue that how are we going to get from cheap energy to cheap energy when and where you need it?
I actually think it's very, very important to look at the economics of this. This is really a snapshot of the German power markets last year, actually, an Easter weekend, actually. And why I've taken Germany is because Germany's in a very unusual situation, which is that, and I think you can see this over, if you look at the 12th of the April on the far left-hand side, what you see is you see yellow and green. Yellow is the solar and green is wind. And the black line up the top is the load. In other words, it's the demand. And what you see on that day, the 12th of April, Germany's peak power demands were just being met by solar and wind. And this is very, very important because there's very few countries in the world have this situation where they have their intermittent capacities are higher than demand, okay? And you can think of it, what happened is Germany's probably adding 6-7 gigawatts of renewables every year. What this means is it's getting worse and worse and worse. So the stress in the system gets worse and worse. Because the question is, if you've got too much solar and too much wind in one day, well, what do you do with the electricity? Well, Germany's in a very lucky situation, which is that it's in the center of Europe and it's very well interconnected into other countries. So that what that means is, it can export the power away and it can import it. And you can see this on the bottom of the graph. You can see the purple and the gray bit down there exactly. So if you take that situation on 19th of April, what's actually happening is Germany is exporting power, right? And you can see on the left here, that means on that day there, 19th of April, Germany was exporting 10 gigawatts worth of power. But you could also see the purple areas. What happens is Germany is importing power. And like it's importing, you can see sometimes it's importing 5 gigawatts. Now, what's very interesting about this graph, though, as you look at it, is what you see is that everything is dependent on solar and wind. So what actually happens is when there's too much solar and wind, Germany's exporting. When there's not enough, Germany's importing. And the other interesting thing that also happens is that the power prices go up and down. But the most interesting...
So which one's the power
price? So the power price are the blue and the red one. Yeah, yeah. Germany's goal alone is to double the level of intermittent renewables that they have by 2030. So that's just going to make this put even more stresses on the system.
Every time someone, you know, invests in renewables is going along intermittency. You know, is adding intermittency in the system. And there are two ways. I mean, this is trading 101. You need space and you need time. Space, you need to be able with interconnector to ship it north, south, east, and west. But there are a lot of conditions which are attached to interconnector because, you know, different countries. Thanks God in Europe, regulations are, you know, pretty much aligned on that. But if you don't trust the other party, if you don't trust that there's going to be, a, you know, second by second, week by week, month by month alignment, very difficult to put interconnectors together. So that's space. And the second is time. And the time can be a few minutes, a few hours. We can have endless discussion about seasonal storage. The two ways to do it in a green way are, number one, the pump hydro. And of course, the second is batteries. The batteries market around the world has been growing phenomenally just because, you know, the price have gone down on the back of the EVs batteries. And this market is going to probably times 10 in the coming decade.
So levelized cost of energy is the standard measure we use to say how expensive it is to produce a kilowatt hour of electricity. And it's, as you see, you know, renewables is the lowest cost way of doing this. Now, the only issue in all of this is that two things happen. What happens is, one is you cannibalize the wholesale price market in general, because what actually ends up, you end up doing is the more and more you put in the system, guess what? You have an overcapacity situation at certain times of the day. And you also have, actually, it changes the whole way the power market works, where the weather actually determines the power price. The yellow band there just gives you an idea of the levelized cost of solar if you're putting it in a field today. So you're in and around sort of 50 euros, between 50 and 60 euros. You can see by 2030, you could be in and around 35 euros lowest. And you go, wow, this is great, man. You know, I'm in a great situation. But the issue is your wholesale power price is still going down because, remember, you're just building more and more renewables. But the second thing more concerning is that your so-called solar capture price. In other words, if I just put a solar farm out there tomorrow, I have no subsidies whatsoever, I'm no feed-in tariff, but I say, I'm just going to buy it, I'm going to just sell my power in the grid. What you see is that. What you see is today, right now, instead of getting the average power price of just below 50, I'm getting maybe 45. But if I go by 2030, my average price could be as low as 5 euros a megawatt hour, right? Now, who the hell is going to build that? But the interesting thing is somebody, I don't care who it is, has to pay for the difference between that wholesale price and that solar capture price. Somebody pays for it. There's actually significant thinking needed in and around how you solve that issue out.
Can we show the next slides? Because I'm going to be...
Yeah, go for it.
Back, 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 back. That's the duck, the famous duck curve. Look, I'm a trader. As a trader, and when I see those curves, I want to own interconnectors and I want to own batteries. Because as I said, everybody went long intermittency. I want to short intermittency. That's where the trading opportunities are. As Charles says, someone's going to compensate. There's going to be the client or the shareholders or the system. But the reality is, in my intraday trade or my day ahead trade, a round trip of $40 per megawatt hour between, you know, the highest and the lowest. Now, $40 round trip for an hour, I can tell you with the new price of batteries, the battery is going to pay for itself and it's going to be extremely well.
If we get this arbitrage working efficiently, won't you see the curve start to flatten out then? Don't you eat away at your own business case the more people are participating in this?
Now, welcome to the trading world. Each good trade bears the seeds of his own destruction.
I thought it interesting to look at what the IEA is talking about. They did a study looking at, this is across the European Union, they're talking now about value-adjusted levelized cost of energy. So the energy value, just assume the power prices today across continental Europe are averaging 50 euros. That's 100%, okay? And the question is, which of these generators, what type of value will they get in the market? Well, what we're seeing with this solar PV, well, actually, if the power price is 50, what they're only going to get is over the course of that lifetime of that asset, they're only going to get 75% of that 50. So they're going to end up at it, right? That's what it's saying. Because again, just the solar is cannibalizing itself in terms of the power price.
Because all the solar comes on together and wind is also correlated, but not as strongly.
And that's why gas up the top there is going to get a higher power price because they're filling in the gaps. It could well be you could put batteries as well up there. But you can see what this is that they're also saying is the more and more variables you put on offshore wind and in particular solar and onshore wind, their value decreases as it goes forward.
So in a certain way, wind and solar, provided you've got good interconnectors, wind is much more valuable than solar when everybody got hit at the same time.
We haven't talked about is hydro, right? And I mean, for me, I think it was quite shocking yesterday. It was shocking to me, right? Because I make an assumption, and Laurent, I think you do too, is that because you see what's going on in the power markets, everybody's reacting to the changes and that these hydropower plants are all flexibilized and stuff like this. But what you realize is all the small hydropower plants across Europe have not in any way digitalized. And what that means by that is they are not set up to actually respond to changes in the weather, to respond to changes in the power prices, et cetera, et cetera. So I would say that there's a huge amount to be done across the whole sector.
No, I mean, hydro, the management of hydro, such a great resource managed so poorly, that's really a scandal. All those hydro guys should be fired, all of them, you know, from top to bottom. And those hydro capacity should be put in different companies that, you know, that manage it for themselves. Because the value, I mean, when you talk about the value of hydro, it's even beyond gas turbine.
Well, if I take the case again, go back to, I can look at the UK as the forefront of how to regulate a world for a decarbonized world. There's no barriers to entry in terms of National Grid needs services. They need balancing services, flexibility services, and it's provided by lowest cost, quickest response. If I take the case of France and Germany, the whole battery thing is a disaster because what you've got is grid charges that prevent you from actually playing that volatility and arbitrage game that Laurent is talking about, right? Mm-hmm. So there are regulatory environments that are very clearly focused against those. So if I'm a pumped hydro, I've got the same issue. Right? I've got grid charges.
It's on purpose.
It's crazy.
It's on purpose. Yeah. They are not here to protect the consumer. They are here to protect the incumbents. Really.
And there's definitely a little bit of that. There's no doubt. And actually, if you want to decarbonize, what we have to do is we need to have smart regulators. There's just no way around this.
So, yeah, I mean, interconnector are very important, but not just from an arbitrage perspective of prices. It's because, you know, you connect to grids, it strengthens both grids, you know, on both sides of the interconnector.
What interconnectors do is they build trust. And that's really, really critical. Because you think of it, if we want to decarbonize our world, we need to trust China. China needs to trust us. I need to trust Poland. Poland needs to trust Germany. That's where what's important. So I think interconnection is very, very important. And I think the second aspect of interconnection is that stabilizes the system. That's what it does. Right?
So, I mean, chapter one took 20 years, but, you know, cost, this is, we want that victory. Now, of course, the fossil fuel is attacking us on, you know, don't call floater, what happens when the wind does not, yada, yada. We hear that. So now we need to work on value.
So thanks a lot to Laurent and Gerard for that call. It was really interesting to get that totally different perspective to just, you know, purely on the technology like I'm usually thinking about. It was really interesting to see that, yeah, okay, so we have done a really great job. We've won the cost side of the battle, but what are we going to do about the value side? And Laurent summed it up pretty well, I think, when he said that there's two components to solving the issues related to adding a whole lot more variable electricity generation. There's the time component and there's the space component. Technology is going to be a big part of the solution for those two areas too. So for the time question, then that's where energy storage comes in. And for the space question, interconnectors. And there's really interesting projects going on in and really interesting technologies being developed for both of these. Thanks again to Laurent and Gerard for the call today. And thank you for watching. And I'll see you in the next video.